This Thursday, Birchwood Art Gallery opens an exciting new group exhibition titled Art for Autumn, and it features works from 10 Manitoba-based artists. From 5:30 to 9 p.m., Birchwood invites you to come and absorb the brilliant variety of works while indulging in a little wine, a few hors d'oeuvres, and some live music. One artist featured in the gallery's show first identified as a concert pianist before turning to painting. From interpreter to creator, she pulls audiences in with the same lyricism and vibrant spectrum in sonic and optic color. Her work can be seen in collections all over the globe, but you can experience a concentration of her work at Birchwood and have a chance to meet her at Thursday evening's opening. I would like to welcome Manitoba's piano woman, Shirley Elias, to the Diamond Lane. How are you?
Thank you, Sarah Jo. I'm kind of drawn in by your vibrancy.
Oh, shucks. Oh my gosh. So first, let me say that I've seen quite a few of your works, and I find the music in it. But can you tell us about your journey from pianist to painter? Like, how did that unfold for you?
First of all, thank you that you see the music in it. Because now I'm not always still painting music per se, mm-hmm. but the subject matter. But there's a voice that I've worked very hard to develop, mm-hmm. and it was early on that a real artist, quote unquote, at the time, because I didn't feel real at the time, said to me, Shirley, you know, develop a voice. And I understood that as a musician, not so much, you know, your alto, mezzo, what, but something that resonates with you.
The language with which you speak.
That's it, yeah. Mm-hmm. And for me as a pianist, it was the big Russian works, the new music works, mm-hmm. the creative process of new music, being involved with the composers mm-hmm. and that whole process. So I kind of understood all that. And then I talked to my composer friends differently early on, like, how do you know when it's done, Randolph, right?
He's a good guy to ask.
Yeah, no, exactly. He's going to tell it to me straight. Speaking of piano woman.
Right.
And he just like, you know, Shirley, the piece will talk to you. And eventually you gain the confidence that, yes, it does. Mm-hmm. And so I wouldn't sign them early on until I knew it's done, right?
Right.
But it's been kind of a natural evolution for me. I did paint and draw a lot as a kid. Mm-hmm. But I came from a musical background, so it was kind of preordained that that's the route I'd be going. But it was always a passion for me. And uh-huh. actually, when I was doing Piano Woman, Morty Walker came over to interview me, and he said, I had paintings everywhere. And he said, what are you doing? I'm like, I don't know. Come back in 10 years. And he did.
Yeah. That's amazing.
And it's just kind of been, you know, it's practicing is the same. I sit in a studio 6-8 hours a day. I do paint
right.
religiously.
Yeah.
It's a job for me, but it's a job I enjoy. And it's not a chore for me. It's not right. work. It is work, physical work, but mm-hmm. it's not stressful work for me to be in the studio all day. Sometimes the deadlines are stressful,
yeah.
but the process is so exciting. And the journey is mm-hmm. always, it unfolds. Before I was the interpreter, and now I'm the creator.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very big different slant. I wasn't the composer. I wasn't an improviser.
Mm-hmm.
And now I have a blank canvas. And that's kind of freeing.
I can imagine.
But then I'm inspired by whoever commissions me. I love the commission process.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to paint your portrait, mm-hmm. but something about you is going to speak to me. Something you listen to, something mm-hmm. about your space, something just about your personality.
Mm-hmm.
It always usually takes me somewhere new. And mm-hmm. so I thrive on that challenge.
Brilliant.
Yeah, no, it's just been, it's been a trip.
Well, there's so many things that you just compacted into that one statement that I have to break down and ask for our audience out there
okay.
who might not be familiar. For example, for first,
okay.
with Randolph Peter's work that was commissioned. Did you commission that work?
Piano Woman? It was a CBC commission.
Oh, it was a CBC commission. So The Adventures of Piano Woman is this remarkable work that demands Shirley to play two pianos at once in some moments. The dueling of the boogie-woogie versus the classical schools.
Yeah.
And did you wear a cape?
No, I wore a split costume.
Oh my
gosh!
So
I was on stage when the lights came up.
Uh-huh.
So these were the days when Du Maurier sponsored
the new music festival.
So the mm-hmm. right side of me was all a tuxedo.
Right.
And then my mother sewed this costume together. And then the left side of me was ripped jeans, the white t-shirt, the cigarette pack under my James Dean look. Yeah.
Nice.
The little, you know, the Converse runners.
Nice.
And so, but from the side, you could probably see my feet, but you couldn't see the other side of me.
That's
incredible. So the first two movements are classical-ish.
Mm-hmm.
And and you're just staying at the piano that you would normally see in front of the orchestra.
Right.
And then it's the third movement. They come out of this tremolo, and we kind of start with Beethoven, and then and I play a little lick from Beethoven, and then I do a 180, and there's another piano right on me, right behind me, mm-hmm. but I'm still on the same bench.
Right.
And the composer, Randolph, wanted me to always face the audience when I made this round the world trip.
Right.
Which is great. Then the audience always gets to see me turn around, but then I have to find the conductor's baton.
Right.
From a 360, right? And it was such tight rhythmic rock music because the other piano was rock and roll.
Yeah.
So I do rock and roll, then I do Liszt, then I do rock and roll, Jerry Lewis.
Yeah.
Then I do Tchaikovsky. We kind of went through the whole list. And then he let me improvise at the cadenza. And then the audience got to decide which piano I ended on. So we didn't know if they participate, but they all had these big 2-foot bright orange cards in their laps, and one had a C and one had an R on each side.
Okay.
And so at the cadenza, the orchestra is tremoloing, and then I stand up and I kind of do the Vanna White thing, like, which piano should I can't decide, what should I do, right?
Yeah.
And so these 2,000 R's came up. It was like
amazing.
This wave of orange. It was so, I would just remember being overwhelmed. What the audience didn't know, though, is there was only one cadenza. So I sat down, and that's when you sit down and you play both pianos.
Okay.
Which, again, wasn't so bad, except that he had me playing soprano on my left hand and bass in my right hand, because, again, he wanted me facing
just
the audience.
Backwards.
So it was all, kind of backwards, right?
It's amazing.
But it was so much fun.
So that's how you garnered the nickname Piano Woman, from Randolph Peters' piece that was premiered with the WSO, Bramwell Tovey at the helm,
correct.
I think. Yeah, amazing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Such a fun
piece.
It was
so fun.
My dear duo partner, Madeline Hildebrand, did it on her master's recital here. Her undergrad recital or post-bac recital, one of them, anyway. She wore a cape and a little...
Yeah, it had kind of a superwoman.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
So fun. Anyway, okay, let's move on. So the other thing that you talked about that I wanted to ask is that interpreter versus creator relationship. And, it's something that I talked to Marc-André Amna when he was in just chatting with me before he played with the Manitoba Chamber Orchestra. He was talking about that symbiosis of being... both an interpreter and a creator, and how being a creator informs your interpretive interpretive brain.
Right.
But I mean, as you started as an interpreter, I mean, how does that inform your? I mean, because you're not composing music per se, but you're composing, this lyrical visual, work in front of you.
Yeah.
I mean, how does that work for you?
Well, and so as I was saying earlier, the commissions kind of is that feed, right? So I'm kind of interpreting.
Right.
What comes to me, not you, but the environment, something prompts the inspiration.
Yeah.
Usually there's a germ there that I got a commission that one of the works that is their desert island piece is Scriabin's Second Piano Sonata, which truly is a desert island piece, right?
Yeah.
Like it's mystical, it's powerful, it's magical.
Mm-hmm.
And it's already, I can see the whole painting in my head.
Yeah.
I listened to it 10 times in a row. And I'm like, I totally know what I'm going to do for this guy.
Amazing.
So there's always something. It's not always music based, right?
Yeah.
But now that I've done so many, I'm up to over 400 paintings.
That's amazing.
I know. It's just, you have to develop your craft.
Right.
And your technique. And now I kind of feel like I've put in my 10,000 hours and I'm just kind of coming out of my shell now, and it's just feeling, I'm feeling more on my feet than I have.
Well, most recently I saw the piece that was commissioned for Henry Engbrecht's retirement from conducting Canzona a year and a half ago, and I know that you had also gone to their home to see where they were planning to put it, and Erica, Henry's wife, is a very colorful, vibrant person, so I think it was wasn't it a yellow wall that they had it put on, but the palette that you used and the motion in the painting was just so very much Henry too, and Erica.
Yeah,
I mean, the two of them both.
Right.
But it was just, it was such a pleasure to see that unveiling.
Cool.
You know, so when we're going to break for a little bit of music, and we're going to do a little bit of Russian since
excellent.
We were talking about Russian works. And what I have set up is a Rachmaninoff prelude from Stephen Osborne, because I'm a huge fan of Rachmaninoff too. Like the Etude Tableaus, I was a teen, they were like my thing. The C sharp minor prelude, but we're going to do the G flat, Opus 10 or Opus 23, number 10, from Stephen Osborne, and we will be back with painter and pianist Shirley Elias after this. Opus 23, number 10, Rachmaninoff. Stephen Osborne. I'm Sarah Jo. You're here with me in the Diamond Lane, and live in the studio, we have pianist, pedagogue, and painter Shirley Elias, who is going to be featured Thursday evening. Well, this whole show, but there's an opening on Thursday evening at Birchwood Art Gallery as part of their Art for Autumn exhibition featuring 10 Manitoba artists. And we have been having a great chat about your journey from pianist to painter. Now, as we continue, the best way I can describe your work is as a synesthetic expression of sonic landscape, really.
That's flattering. Thank you.
I mean, because when you look at your work, I mean, you hear that music in it. But as a musician and as a pedagogue, how do you feel that pedagogical element comes in? Because you teach at CMU, and you were just telling me you have a studio of about 20 students, which is quite a bit.
That's a lot. Yeah.
And how do you bring your artistic sense into your teaching?
I find, well, the students are so inspiring, right? Because they're the next generation, and so they just bring that youthfulness back to your thinking. Because you know, we're all aging, so their energy is kind of refreshing.
Yeah.
But it's that. Their voices, they're searching, they're looking, they're learning. It's a big journey for them, right? And it's nice to be part of that journey. You kind of feel like you're part of the musical evolutional scale. So this year, actually, what I've done is Mussorgsky's Pictures and Exhibition was on my two playlist at some point. And then I never did because I got caught up in Rachmaninoff and a couple other people. Mm-hmm. And so then now it's on my to paint list. And so it's always been, I don't want to, because it was based on a series of paintings, right? So I don't want to recreate those. But like you said, what moves me, and it will be my inspiration from the music itself. And I understand it as a pianist, so I'm having the kids each play a movement or two. And I don't know if I'll get all the movements done by the time the semester's over, but time is ticking. But it's something we can work on together. So when we work on it in lessons, I'm like, so just talk to me out loud, right? What are your feelings of this piece? Not technically, and the things that they say is always inspiring, which is similar to the commission. They don't realize they're kind of commissioning me, right?
Right.
That's what people, they just start talking, and you go, oh, and it sparks something in my brain, and going, oh yeah, I can totally see how I could feed that in. So that's been kind of fun. So I kind of try and marry those two worlds wherever I can.
Beautiful. And you know what? And the marriage of art and music, visual art and music, is something that so many composers have pulled on, not just Mussorgsky, but Poulenc in his Travail du Peintre, Ottorino Respighi in his the Botticelli triptych. Really, just so many of them. I mean, when you don't have text to be inspired, why not be inspired by these brilliant images and these textures?
I did Messiaen's Quartet for the End of Time because he had synesthesia, right?
Yes.
So it was a text, the Revelations text, but he describes the colors. Not just, you know, it's blue, it's Prussian blue, or he was very specific in the energies that he saw. And so it was kind of intense, but it was 11 feet long, a series of eight paintings, one for each movement. And they actually did tie together. Pictures one, they'll probably be standalone pieces. But that was kind of a nice process to go through and to read his words and then take my own spin on that. And same with this Mussorgsky I was just reading, because Kandinsky actually did installation based on this. It was the only time he ever took a pre-written piece. And because he loved the piece so much. But he said the piece is, it's not me reinterpreting Victor Hartmann's works.
Right.
It's me interpreting Mussorgsky's impressions and his emotions. Because the piece is so powerful. And so now he's interpreting, it's sort of an evolution again, right?
Beautiful.
And Kandinsky's kind of, it's such different work than mine, but he's kind of a mentor for me.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
So what else can we expect from Thursday night's opening? I hear Larry Rich, who is another one of the featured artists. He's I've seen some of his birch paintings.
Yes.
But he also does, you know, kind of jazz inspired portraiture, because he's a jazz bassist, right?
Yes, yeah.
And he'll be accompanying the evening with his bass and a looper, I hear.
Okay.
Which is going to be super fun. You know, we've got Cindy Dyson, who is also super familiar for her vignettes of Winnipeg, very brightly colored, yeah, really, yeah, yeah, you know, splashy. Yeah. Then Hubert Theroux, his prairie landscapes,
right,
gorgeous, really, really, really beautiful, very much more representative realist kind of style, but just very Manitoba. Mm-hmm. What else are we expecting?
You've named a lot of them there. One that I was going to also mention was Jason Poturica,
right,
who does the photographs.
Right.
And it's one of the first art pieces that I've bought.
Oh, congratulations.
But I walked in and I saw that up on the wall. And I've been a fan of his work since he joined the gallery. Mm. But I walked in when they brought the new Peggy's Cove piece, which is on the little postcard for the show.
That's right.
And I fell in love with it. My husband's from Halifax.
Oh, beautiful.
So in my own world, I was buying him a gift. But really, I was just kind of buying myself a gift.
Well, it's a joint gift. It will benefit both of your artistic souls, I'm sure.
But it was just the energy. I kind of had that experience for the first time of walking into a space going, I need to have that piece.
Yeah.
And I told him it's the only piece I've purchased, and it's like front and center in my house. And
he does these beautiful miniature stagings.
Yeah.
And he does lots of kind of bucolic stuff as well, just really, really unique work.
Yeah, it's very interesting.
So fun. Yeah. So, hey, we should just invite people to come to this. I know I'm going to be there on Thursday. After I'm done my show, I'm going to head over there with my dear friend, who's also a painter, Wanda Luna. She just had some works featured at Virtuosi as part of the Raven and the First Men piece, Tim Corliss's new piece that was up. She's great too, but I'm gonna suck her in and we're gonna come together Thursday night from 5:30 to 9, the opening of Art for Autumn at Birchwood Art Gallery, located at 70 Taylor Avenue, suite number 11, an exhibition featuring selected works from 10 Manitoba artists who will be there for you to meet and inquire further about their art and artistic journeys. For more information, you can go to our website, classic107.com, or go to Birchwood's website, Birchwood Art Gallery, all one word, .com. Shirley Elias, painter, pedagogue, and pianist extraordinaire. So lovely to have you
in. Thank you so much.
It's been such
a delight.
And I'm so excited to see your works.
Oh, thank you so much.
All right. We are going to usher you out on the Great Gate of Kiev of Mussorgsky's Pictures and Exhibition, Ivo Pogorelich at the piano.